Welcome back to Northwest City Politics in the Know with Juanita. We're happy that you're joining us again this evening. We're glad that there's people like you out there, people who are interested in what's happening on in our cities. If you haven't watched us before, we are on CCX's viewing channels and we cover 9 cities, and we'll bring people from city councils and mayors to tell you about what activities are taking place in our cities or will be taking place in the future, so you can keep up and hopefully get your ideas in on issues that resonate with you. I'm very happy tonight to welcome to our city council portion. We've got Dan Ryan from Brooklyn Center, and you've been on our program several times, right?
Yes, Juanita. Great to be with you again.
Yeah, we're glad to have you. And I asked you ahead of time if you would just kind of briefly introduce yourself out there to our wider audience, because people from Brooklyn Center would probably know you, but other people from other cities might not.
Well, thank you for that, Juanita. Again, I'm Dan Ryan, council member, City of Brooklyn Center. The city's been my home for most of my life. I attended Earl Brown Elementary and Brooklyn Center High School. I earned a bachelor's degree from the University of Minnesota. My last full-time position, I was procurement and materials manager for a metal finishing operation in Fridley, Minnesota. I retired in 2011. My wife Nora and I will celebrate our 30th wedding anniversary in August.
Oh, congratulations in advance.
Thank you. And a lot of help and support from Nora has made my civic involvement that much more productive.
Oh, I'm sure.
Thank you, Nora. I was first elected to the City Council in 2006, and I was I won re-election my fourth term last November. It has been my honor and privilege to serve the city and the citizens of Brooklyn Center the last 12 years in that capacity.
Yeah, that you've seen a lot of changes happen over that time.
Yes, I have.
And then I thought we'd start out talking about citizen engagement, community outreach, because I know that Brooklyn Center is involved in quite a bit of that, and maybe you're have a leadership role right around the area. But you hold, and we've referred to them, you hold 4 sessions in the summer in different parts of the city. How many parts do you have all told?
Well, we have, last count, I believe 16.
Okay, so you after 4 years, you've covered all of them then.
Well, we rotate the parks.
Yeah, that's
so
what I was
So basically,
trying to...
we do a park meeting in every corner of the city. That the actual park varies from year to year. And typically, the people that go to those meetings, it's their park.
Right.
It's their immediate neighborhood.
Right.
And those are the folks you'll see at those meetings.
Mm-hmm.
And if I could say a little bit more about them.
Kind of what you do.
Sure. Well, initially the meeting started out with more of a public safety focus because of things that were happening across the metro in the very early 2000s. And we've been doing, this is our 11th year. And really have turned things around in that respect. So interest has shifted into more a broad spectrum of activities and programs by the city. And while the chief of police chairs the meetings, he has senior staff, the department heads, each come up and give a presentation on their department's activities. And of course, every year there's a lot of interest in the public works because we have that program to replace our streets in public utilities, where you do several blocks every year. And we're closing in on completing that program. A 30-year program will complete in 2023.
That's pretty good.
Good stewardship.
Right, definitely. Now, you said for the last 11 years you've been holding those meetings in the park. That's starting at a point where there wasn't a lot of that kind of activity in other cities.
That's correct. Before I began my service, there were attempts to have folks come to the civics, or our community center.
Right.
And conduct the same meetings, but folks weren't turning out. So I think the key was to have this type of a meeting on a very informal basis in a place where folks feel comfortable and relaxed and in a very welcoming setting.
Right.
And of course, if you give them pizza and egg rolls.
Right, right.
And that's really what I think has produced a lot of success in that regard. And the department heads will do a brief presentation, and then after that, we conduct a quick spot poll. And uh-huh. That's why I brought this along.
Oh,
and
okay.
This is a device that's used by the police chief who does a quiz on the attendees. And it's just real general questions about
right.
How do you feel about your neighborhood, how do you feel about the city, what are your major issues, do you feel safe in your home, do you feel safe in the park, and so on. And so they'll push these buttons.
Okay, so you have you bring a bunch of these
yes,
pads out.
Yeah, we distribute these to the attendees.
Okay.
And at the appropriate prompt, they enter their response.
Ah, so you get direct information from them.
Right. And that
a lot of people at one time.
Yes. And, you know, we'll get 60 people turn out for uh-huh. one of these events. And again, it's a small sample relative to the 32,000
right.
people
right.
in the city. But it's a really great device to get sort of your finger on the pulse. And we've been doing that, about the last 5-6 years, I think. And the council gets a report after each
right.
after each park meeting.
What are some of the benefits that the council sees from doing that?
Well, of course, it gives the staff and the council an opportunity to meet people in their neighborhoods.
Right.
And I think even in the age of electronic communication and Facebook and so on, nothing beats face-to-face interaction and as a way to build relationships.
Uh-huh.
And the other great benefit is that while we bring a lot of information about what the city's doing,
right.
we like to make it as much of a dialogue as we can, because as important as what we feel we're telling the citizens, what the citizens tell us sometimes is even more important.
Right, right. And then are there other types of engagement that your city is reaching out to people with?
Oh, yes. I mean, there's really a lot of different means of communication and
right.
outreach and so on. And like many cities, we do have a newsletter.
Oh, right.
It has been published quarterly. We're looking at putting it out 6 times a year.
Ah.
And again, this is what a lot of cities do. The back part of it is devoted to all of our recreation programs.
Oh,
so we have a very full array of recreation programs. And one of the things I should have mentioned when I talked about why it would be great to buy a home in Brooklyn Center is our community center. It's a gem. Exercise
very
room.
Nice.
Yeah. Olympic pool
mm-hmm.
inside. Now,
right.
New Hope has a
Olympic
pool.
It will be. Right.
Right. So, not going to get a lot of business in the winter.
Right.
But a lot of our seniors do aquatic exercise
mm-hmm.
classes, and we have a full array of activities, and certainly these athletic programs for the kids. And, you know, it's a great thing to get young people started in physical activity. It builds the foundation for a healthier
uh-huh.
life. And we were concerned that our kids weren't getting to the community center
uh-huh.
to make use of these programs. So we're looking at even lowering our fees or eliminating fees
uh-huh.
for some classes, some activities. And we have something called Rec on the Go.
Ah.
Rec on the Go was funded through the Twin Stadium.
Okay.
They had
to put some money in youth activities, didn't they?
Yes, that's exactly right.
When they set it up.
Yeah, I think we have Mike O'Pat and
mm-hmm.
other county commissioners to thank for that.
That
is a very, very good program. It helped us to build the Blue Barn at Brooklyn Center High School. And now with the vans that we equip with playground gear,
right.
we send rec directors out to the parks.
Yeah,
bringing recreation programs
right.
out to the kids who can't get to or it can't get as often to the community center.
Right. So you have to always kind of keep changing to meet changing needs in the community.
Oh, exactly. And that's just one example. I mean, we have a set of activities that I class as civic betterment activities that bring people together, that build the human capital in the community. The National Night Out.
I'm sure
a lot of cities participate in that. And of course, we do a National Night Out kickoff party the Monday night before. This year, it's August 5th.
Uh-huh.
And National Night Out is the 6th, Tuesday the 6th of August.
Uh-huh.
And that, of course, is, we leave those flyers.
And then people are more aware of it.
Right, and we post on our website naturally.
Yeah.
We also have the Shingle Creek Cleanup, where Public Works provides supplies for volunteers.
That
coincides with Earth Day. And we have a new program, the Neighborhood Engagement Program, which is not to be confused with the neighborhood area park meetings. This is a new program. We just started it. And I took this from the city's website. And it displays the parks across the whole
city. Right.
Yeah, and so the neighborhoods are identified
by their neighborhood
park. And the object of the neighborhood engagement program is to get neighbors to come together, have a meeting, learn what the city could do to support their civic activities, their neighborhood-focused projects. It might be that you'd want to put up a couple neighbors would want to put up one of those mini libraries in their front lawn, or remove buckthorn or other invasive species, especially if the neighborhood's near Shingle Creek along the river. It might be simply to organize folks to get out and do a cleanup after all the snow melts, because we know what that looks like everywhere. Folks in Brooklyn Center have a lot of pride. I got emails complaining about why is it there's so much refuse along Brooklyn Boulevard after the snow melts, but I try to remind them that that's pretty much a societal-wide problem.
Right.
But with neighbors engaged, improve their neighborhoods, and these should be projects that the local folks would decide what they would like to do. And it's the objective of the neighborhood engagement personnel that we've added to our staff, they're part-timers, to work with those engagement groups and get the necessary support, logistical support, or
materials. Kind of a connection to the city.
Exactly. Largely through, I imagine, the first Public Works, Parks and Rec.
Right.
And of course, then there's Black History Month, and we've had the Community Health Fair, which we ran this spring. And the that was in partnership with the Brooklyn Center Community Schools, District 286, my old high school, Brooklyn Center High School. And the goal of the Community Health Fair is to educate individuals about the health, wellness, and fitness decisions they make for themselves and their families. Through the support of community partners, the city offered speakers, demonstrations, service-based vending booths that provided health screenings, services, and fitness information. And it was included live entertainment, fun for the kids, and most importantly, it was free.
Then, well, let's shift gears.
Sure.
Now, Brooklyn Center and Lattice are meeting about your opportunity site. First, we should tell people, what is your opportunity site and where is it located? And why is it called an opportunity site?
Right, and actually, I appreciate that question, and the way that the term opportunity site has been used, I can appreciate the fact that it might cause some confusion with folks for a couple of reasons.
Okay.
One is that the actual opportunity site is the 80 acres area located north of Bass Lake Road, east of Shingle Creek Parkway, south of Summit Drive, and west of Highway 100.
Right. And there used to be a car dealership or something in there, right?
A long time ago? Yes, on the very the very lowest, actually along facing Bass Lake Road, that was Brookdale Ford.
Yes.
Sorry, I just had to think about that for a moment. But if you Google opportunity site and you, it takes you to the first item that I checked the other day, it takes you to our website, and it lists the opportunity site as 100 acres.
Ah.
That is because that was the opportunity site study area.
Ah.
The, I believe it's the adjacent uses that the Hennepin County Service Center, the
right.
Brookdale Library, Aon, the high-rise apartment building next to City Hall, those uses aren't going to go away.
Uh-huh.
They were included in the study area.
Sure.
Because those are assets we want to leverage with development
right.
that will occur
right.
within the opportunity site proper.
Yeah, and that makes sense.
And then, of course, the recent discussion has focused, just as you said, on the Brookdale Ford and the former Brookdale Square property.
Right.
There used to be a Circuit City. And then more recently, there was a Pep Boys in
right.
that strip mall that was ran parallel to the Brookdale Ford building to the north. But that's 32 acres. We kind of expected that that would be the initial redevelopment
uh-huh.
that would occur there. And again, another thing that lends itself to people being a little bit uncertain what we mean by opportunity site, in the 2017 federal tax code revision, that involved a program called Opportunity Zones, mm-hmm. wherein the U.S. Treasury Department identifies by certain zip codes
right.
Areas where when redevelopment occurs, those who invest in those projects can receive very favorable tax treatment
right.
on their
right.
capital gains,
right.
if I hope I'm correct on that. And we were waiting for typically for a complex piece of federal legislation
sure.
that rolls out like changes in the federal tax code, it requires a considerable amount of rulemaking, in this
of
case
course.
By the Treasury Department. Of course,
right.
they run that sort of thing. Then when this came out, investors are seeing such great opportunities. So again, the appropriate use of that
yes.
term here
yes.
in this case,
right.
because there's so much potential unrealized
in that
area. And the city's had quite a challenge because while we own a total of 35 acres
uh-huh.
in the area from John Martin south to Bass Lake Road, we don't own property from.
And now, the meetings that you're having with the Lattice, mm-hmm. what's happening at those meetings?
Well, we had four evening workshops this spring
okay.
at the Brookdale Library. We pulled I'll describe the first of the three meetings,
sure.
and I think that will
okay.
give you a sense of what this is, how this works. They were conducted by a group called LISC, which is the Local Initiative Support Corporation.
Okay.
And they specialize in this type of undertaking, as the name implies. Their objective is to get communities involved in projects, major or relatively small,
uh-huh.
whatever the case may be, and get people engaged in being part of the planning and decision-making
mm-hmm.
process. And so that was really our goal. And we were very fortunate to have this developer, Alitus,
uh-huh.
who is very much oriented in that regard toward community engagement, determining what are the values and the interests of residents
right.
and what their expectations are. So the first meeting held in March, we polled residents about what they thought was important about the site and their concerns and expectations about
uh-huh.
what might or might not happen.
Okay.
The second meeting in April, attendees got to try their hand at being developers themselves and doing model scale model
uh-huh.
layouts, then having the results reviewed by a development finance expert.
Uh-huh.
And as we know, finances is a critical piece of the puzzle.
Right.
We have to find
right.
out what's feasible. There may be projects that are so critical, of such critical importance to the city, that there is what's called a financing gap, and those projects might be subsidized.
Oh, sure.
You know, there is argument to be made there because, of course, the object is to make a property that has old buildings, old parking lot, that the pavement has to be removed. Much like you saw,
right.
the biggest example was when we removed the old Brookdale Mall that had failed.
Oh, right.
And it required soil mediation because the property was built in 1962. There was asbestos mitigation. Well, the question is, how do you make a property the equivalent development cost to the developer for a property like that,
right,
as opposed to a greenfield like out west of Maple Grove, where's nothing there.
You're just starting off fresh.
Yeah, and there's no soil impairment or anything like that. And that's really the reason we use an instrument like tax increment financing. And I thought I'd just mention that because that really was to help to inform and educate participants.
Oh, yes.
Because this is an elaborate and a complicated process. And those of us who are the board members, the council members, who set policy and decide what should or shouldn't be done, we're just amateurs too.
Well, yeah.
And we need professional staff to guide us, help us navigate that process. Then the third session, there was a panel of experts, including Bob Lux, a couple of affordable housing experts, a community organizer, and a real estate professional who had done a lot of real estate, commercial real estate transactions in the city, going back to the 80s and 90s.
Right.
And that gave us a lot of insight in terms of what they thought the best...
for that kind of site, right?
Yeah, the best to put... What would fulfill the potential for that and be in their view be in the interest of the city as well. And then following their panel discussion, there was an extended question and answer period with participants. And the great thing about this is each of the four sessions, the number of participants, attendees increased.
Right. Oh, that's very promising.
Yeah, and then at the last meeting, it was really important because it gave the attendees the chance to edit the report through a consensus process.
Right.
And so the report really summarized the community's values, interests, and expectations for the site. And although the recommendations were quite general, that report was passed on to the City Council. We received that report from LISC at our June 10th meeting.
Uh-huh. So that's just kind of newly completed.
Yes.
Now, is that report available on your website for people to read?
I believe it is, yes.
Because that would be a good place for people to start if they have an interest in what's going to happen in that area to pick up on what's already been talked about and discussed. But that's really getting people involved.
Yes.
Yeah.
And what the attendees, the participants, all of us together came up with what we felt would be appropriate for the site would be called mixed use.
Okay.
That is the appropriate commercial and residential uses together. I envision it something like what I've seen on Excelsior Boulevard.
I guess
the old Apache Plaza in St. Anthony.
Yeah.
There, the community, city council staff, and the developer were, as I said, were in general agreement, recognized the potential to create a mixed use, walkable town center that incorporates housing, service, retail, entertainment, restaurants, and green space.
Yeah, and there's enough room that you can do that, right?
Right.
Now, switching gears completely, is that Brooklyn Center is a city that has several immigrant groups in it. What countries mainly are settling into your area?
Brooklyn Center and Brooklyn Park, I believe, have
both cities.
The largest population of Liberians, I think maybe in the United States. So our African immigrant population, I believe, is predominantly West African.
Mm-hmm.
So we have some folks from Sierra Leone and Nigeria. We have a few East Africans too.
Uh-huh.
The principal engagement we have with our immigrant community is probably through starting with the Joint Community Police Partnership, the MAC, which I believe we talked about at length
in a previous meeting. And then you recently had a meeting for immigrants to help them learn about differences where they came from and where they are now, right?
Yeah, you know, and we did some of that through Black History Month, but also we were, Brooklyn Center and Brooklyn Park really took the lead on helping to fight the Ebola crisis from 2014. And we also, we're looking at a whole set of different kind of engagement activities and bringing in the ACER, the African Community Education Resources Group, get them more involved with, we're not finished with public engagement on the opportunity side.
Right.
And one of the things we're considering is seeing, it may not be a great number of spaces, it hasn't been resolved yet, but we're looking at the prospect of providing some space for immigrant businesses in the new opportunity site development. Of course, that will require subsidy because, and it may be controversial because, as you understand, the cost of any construction makes lease expense prohibitive for a lot of small businesses.
Right. And then I asked you to think about Brooklyn Center. If you were going to tell somebody, why is Brooklyn Center a good place to buy your home?
Great question. And I would start with the fact we have great neighborhoods. We have great neighbors. We'll talk about, I imagine we'll talk about the four neighborhood area park meetings here shortly. And I love those events because I get to go to each corner of the city every season from late spring through into the early fall and meet folks directly. And I can see what great neighbors they would be for someone coming into the city. And of course, Brooklyn Center is very affordable.
Right.
We have a great supply of mid-century homes, most of which have been very well maintained, and many of them have been significantly upgraded. And going by the estimated market value that you see on your tax statement, that that median value for Brooklyn Center is $198,000.
Oh, that's pretty good.
And when you look at the housing market, it's very difficult to get anything decent under $250,000. You know,
houses in Brooklyn Center must sell fast right now.
Yes, there was a family just down the street from us on the west side, a couple doors from Unity Avenue. They sold in 3 days.
Well, I want to thank you so much. We've gone over a lot of information, but you can see that Brooklyn Center is involved in a lot of things, working towards your future, right? But also meeting your current needs. So we're glad to have you with us. And we'll encourage you to tune in next week because we've got a part two on Brooklyn Center's issues. And we're glad you joined us and we'll hope you'll come back. Bye.